I dreamed I saw Joe Hill last night, alive as you and me. Says I, but Joe, here 10 years dead, I never died, says he. I never died, says he. In Salt Lake City, Joe says I, him standing by my bed. They framed you on a murder charge, says Joe, but I'm dead. Says Joe, but I'm dead. The copper bosses killed you, Joe. They shot you, Joe, says I. Takes more than guns to kill a man, says Joe, I didn't die. Says Joe, I didn't die. And standing there as big as life, and smiling with his eyes, says Joe, what they can never kill, went on to organize, went on to organize.
Welcome everyone to the second lecture of the Rising Tide series, Towards an Age of Creative Reason, Why the Poetic Principles Imperative to Statecraft. And we have a really great class today that Matt is gonna go over with Paul Robeson. I think that Matt's class is really important because the situation that we're in today, not only within divide that we see in countries such as the United States, but you know, divide between countries' relations, where there has been such a buildup of conflict and tension that communication is breaking down on all levels of society and international relations. And obviously this isn't just a natural occurrence, but nonetheless, a lot of goodwill people are feeling, you know, that the situation is somewhat hopeless. One thing for us to keep in mind is that when we look at history has been full of these types of crisis moments. It's obviously not fun when you're living in the moment within them, but when we take a step back and remind ourselves that many times humanity did turn around and did get its act together, we should feel slightly comforted by that. But in terms of the solutions for today, I think that there's a real risk that people get stuck into the pragmatic way of thinking. So we obviously want solutions, real solutions that are going to fix a lot of the problems that we're facing, not only in terms of political solutions, but economic solutions as well. But the question is, what is the limitation to a pragmatic approach? That is, what caused us to get into such a crisis situation? If it's because we've been doing certain things the wrong way, pragmatism isn't going to cut it. You're going to have to think outside of the box, so to speak. And a lot of people have been disempowered in an unnatural way, in the sense that they don't recognize that there is actually a power in the arts, for instance. There is a power in just having goodwill and wanting to have dialogue. A lot of people don't even think dialogue is a real tool nowadays. So Matt will be going over the life of Paul Robeson, which I think is probably the most effective artist of the 20th century for political action. And he was able to unite people from not just within the United States, but all around the world, to come together against the common enemy of mankind or humankind, which is imperialism, which is a form of fascism that the neo-fascism that we saw come out of World War II under the McCarthyite age, in which we kind of see coming back in a form within the United States today, in terms of this, hunting Russian sympathizers and or Chinese sympathizers. So it's a very dangerous time when you have freedom of speech cut down like this. So I think without further ado, I'll let Matt get started his wonderful class, since it's going to be quite detailed. Take it away, Matt.
Thank you, Cynthia, for that nice introduction. And I think you set the tone very well. Because indeed, like the study of history, I think, again, I always state this at the beginning of my classes, because I don't think that this resonates enough with people, but the real purpose of history, what is it? Is it just to like be entertained? No, it's to understand what are the principles governing our reality, and with the focus of looking for insights that will help us solve problems that are holding us back from having a future, which is needed for all of our species to have, you know? We have a lot of crises right now. You've already mentioned the resurgence of a new form of Cold War thinking, a real groupthink mentality, which is taking otherwise nice people and herding them into a situation where they're advocates and even pushers of policies that are not coming from the masses, from the people who are doing a lot of the work, a lot of the instigation, but from higher up. And this is something which can only be addressed. I mean, I think that Paul Robeson did a really... It exemplifies the right approach to thinking about political change, the types of thinking needed for proper forms of revolutionary thinking that are very rare today, because a big chunk of this, I mean, comes from the culture, right? Like, why do people fall into groupthink? Why do they give up their internal powers of reason and sovereignty in favor of allowing a mob mentality to govern, or popular opinion to govern, what they feel and think and what their convictions are? And Paul Robeson, as well as a lot of the best, all of the best historical figures in history, understood that it was a matter of culture. And that if you have a certain approach, a certain field of culture that encourages people to develop their enjoyments, their pleasures, right, their aesthetical tastes in harmony with reason, not to say that it should be dominated by pure logic, but that one's, just like one learns to talk, we learn how to eat solid foods, we learn how to walk over time, our bodies mature, so too should our souls increasingly mature from infant to a mature, functional, sovereign human being. And that's the point of a proper culture. Robeson, I only knew of him from the standpoint of culture for most of my life. And it was only somewhat recently that I discovered that there was so much more to him. I knew of him as a singer, as an actor. I knew he had some political activism behind him, but I didn't know that much more than that. And it's difficult sometimes when thinking about Robeson, because he's somebody who is a bit of an enigma for many people today, since if you look at him as a person, he was a, my phone is just overloading me with messages here. Could you please?
Yeah.
Thank you. Sorry. so Robeson himself is considered an American patriot. He was an American patriot. He loved the Constitution. He defended the founding fathers. He defended Lincoln. He was an advocate of Roosevelt's policies. But he's also considered a traitorous socialist who hated America, who attacked America during the important Cold War years against the Soviets. And he's still vilified to this day. Even reading Wikipedia, there's a certain accommodation to the McCarthyite interpretation of what he was. None of these things are fully true, but because most people don't realize that there's not one, but there has always been two Americas at war with each other. the American Revolution was never something which was finalized as a total victory in 1783. It was something which has continued for the past 250 years. There's always been one thing that today some people might call deep state or whatever, but there's been one more Wall Street pro-imperial aspect of America, and then there's been the constitutional America, and these things have been at odds with each other. Robeson took a side. And this is what I want to say a little something about. I'm going to use a lot of audio recordings in my class. It's the first time we've done audio. I'm hoping that it goes smoothly for everybody. But in thinking about the opening statement I wanted to just read aloud here, which I think characterizes Robeson's soul most concretely, is from a speech he gave in 1937 in support of the Republican resistance in Spain. And this is sort of, I think, a good mission statement, which he stated then, but that really emanates throughout his life from his teenage years all the way through his elderly years, where he says, famously, "Every artist, every scientist, every writer must decide now where he stands. He has no alternative. There is no standing above the conflict on Olympian heights. There are no impartial observers. The battlefront is everywhere. There is no sheltered rear. The artist must take sides. He must elect to fight for freedom or for slavery. I have made my choice. I have no alternative. The history of this era is characterized by the degradation of my people, despoiled of their lands, their culture destroyed. They are in every country, save one, denied equal protection of the law and deprived of their rightful place in the respect of their fellows. Again, I say, the true artist cannot hold himself aloof. The legacy of culture from our predecessors is in danger. It is the foundation upon which we build a still more lofty edifice. It belongs not only to us, not only to the present generation, it belongs to posterity and must be defended to the death." So this is, again, right at the cusp of World War II, when he's in Spain rallying the troops, so to speak, including international forces from Canada, from the US, who are fighting alongside Republican forces in Spain against Franco and the Axis interests who had backed up Franco's coup in 1935-36 in that area. and Robeson did end up going there in 1938. So to understand Robeson as a singer, as an artist, as a freedom fighter, as a political activist, as the founder of largely the civil rights movement in America as we know it in the 20th century, I think that it's important to dig a little bit more deeply into his past briefly. So I broke up this presentation into several acts that I think encapsulate different stages of his development. It's never easy to sort of take linear chunks of time from somebody's life and say, this is one act, this is another. But I think there were specific periods that represented quantum leaps in his evolution as a world historic figure. So starting with this first act, I just want to deal with a period of his childhood when he was born in 1898 in New Jersey, all the way to the 1922 period. What you see in front of you right there is his family home growing up. There's a drawing of his mother, Maria Robeson, and his father, William Robeson, that I think it cannot be overstated how important of an influence his father had on him. His father's a real singularity unto himself. He was a minister. I'll have a picture of the church that he preached at in Witherspoon Street Presbyterian Church until he got fired. But he was not only a preacher, before that he was a slave. He was born into slavery, and during the Civil War he escaped. He took the liberty to escape, and he joined Lincoln's forces in the Union Army, and he fought for several years, after which he was such a force. I mean, there's not that much written, and I think a real biography of his father really has to be tackled at some point. But he ended up getting 2 university degrees. He mastered the classics, philosophy, Greek, Latin, and then became a preacher. Now, Robeson wrote in 1958 about his father, just saying, just as in youth, he had refused to remain a slave, so in all the years of his manhood, he disdained to be an Uncle Tom. From him, we learned, that's him and his brother, we learned and never doubted it, that the Negro was in every way the equal of the white man, and we fiercely resolved to prove it. So his mother dies when he's 5 years old. His mother dies in a house fire. It's somewhat traumatic. The father moves the family to a certain point after he gets fired, around that same time. The father had gotten in trouble because he had organized meetings to deal with the lynchings in I'll still call them Confederate states, because I mean, the KKK was going through a massive revival, and lynchings were on the rise, segregation was on the rise, and it was getting really, really ugly. So he organized some meetings in the basement of one of these churches, and then one of these churches happened to be the church that he preached at, and Witherspoon happened to be run by certain people who had sympathies to the segregationists, and fired him. So he had to move from Princeton to Somerville. William Robeson ensured that his children would receive the best education from himself if he couldn't necessarily get it at the beginning from the public education system. So he taught his kids Greek and Latin as well as the classics when they were only children. He taught them also philosophy. Paul Robeson, at an early age, in high school, there wasn't a lot of segregation in that part of New Jersey that he moved to. Princeton, where he was born, had a lot of problems because largely the Woodrow Wilson factor of Princeton had run amok, and Wilson was an ardent supporter of the KKK and really led in the revival of the KKK while he was president of Princeton University. And that just welcomed a lot of the top elites from all of the southern states into Princeton. So it was a really bigoted area of the North at that time. So this new area where he went to school, lot less racism. It was it had a good climate for him to really develop his mind, and he ended up getting he aced some state exams and ended up winning a full scholarship to Rutgers University. That's him at the age of 12. He started playing football very early on. That's his father's church. Now, in Rutgers, this guy is a phenomenon. He ends up getting 12 varsity letters. He's the top football player in his school, as well as interstate championships. Like, this guy is just winning everything that they could throw at him. He's also excelling in baseball and track and field. That's him on the track and field team. You see a picture of him playing baseball as the catcher. Now, Robeson is just, again, unstoppable. I had a picture here from a Wisconsin News colored star player. Colored star plays here. This guy was a national phenomenon. He he actually ended up playing in the first Super Bowl in 1922. So he actually played against the Chicago Bears. And people thought, you know, he was potentially going to do that. Now, he also sang in the school choirs, in the glee clubs. He was an orator. He won 4 back-to-back oration contests. And that was just 3 days. The last one that he won was just 3 days after his father had died. And his father put a lot of hope into him winning this thing. And so he followed through and actually did it. And in this thing, when he was 19 years old, he goes through his hopes for a new age of mankind. And you could already see, and I'll make this speech available for people. You can read it. You can already see this world historic figure in a germ seed discussing how World War One that was just ending was actually the potential for a new age of brotherhood for all mankind. And he was committed to that throughout his whole life. Now, beyond Rutgers, he ends up going to Columbia University in New York. So after he gets all of these varsity scholarships, he wins more scholarships. He ends up studying law, and he graduates with a law degree. And his intent is to go into law and reform the legal codes. I mean, Jim Crow laws were actually being enforced by the Supreme Court while he was alive. This is something he wanted to do battle with, but an ugly truth slapped him in the face on the first job that he got, and he was working in a New York law office in Harlem. And one of the white secretaries, very early on, refused to take diction for him when he asked her for her assistance, and she insulted him in one of the worst ways you can insult a black man who's working as a lawyer. And his bosses didn't do very much about it. And it became very clear that none of the clients were ever going to use a black lawyer, and that he was going to be relegated to really secondary things throughout his career if he chose to stay in that career, which he didn't. So at that point, he decides to increasingly focus on the arts. And he'd already been working on the side as a stage actor. He hadn't really been known much as a singer at that time. He was working in stage acting. He did some off-Broadway plays. He did one Broadway play called Taboo that didn't really go very well, but he was still recognized as a talent. And he started performing in Eugene O'Neill's performances too, like All God's Children Got Wings. And started making a pretty big name of himself. And this is during the period in the early 20s, during the Harlem Renaissance. It's a period where it was a very rich, cultural, bustling period in Harlem. You had the studies of the classics. You had the arts. Music was really just saturating all of the elementary schools, all of the community centers. Concerts, plays were something that were very easy and affordable for anybody to access. And it was really just, again, a very exciting time to be an artist in New York. So he just fit right in. He was already a bit of a celebrity. Keeping in mind, when he was in Rutgers, he was only the third black student to ever be in Rutgers University. And when he was there, he was the only one. And he had to deal, even though, he got these scholarships, he had to deal with a lot of racism, as excellent of a student as he was on every level. He wasn't allowed, for example, when they toured the Glee Club, when he would, he was part of the choral groups. When they toured to other states, he wasn't allowed to stay in the same motels with his classmates. He wasn't allowed to even travel to stay on the campus at first. He wasn't allowed to live on the campus because he was the only black student, and they had a segregated campus. So he had to live with some African-American family far away off campus and transit to school. At one point, he had a huge insult where one of the universities in Virginia during a football game refused to play a major football match if he was going to be playing. They didn't want to have a black person touching their white athletes. And the school, Rutgers, actually put pressure on the coach that forced him to sit it out. You can only imagine too, playing football is a very physical process, right? And as the only black kid, often competing with very racist schools, there were a lot of cheap shots against him. He had nails ripped out, he had his shoulder broken. There was a lot of cheap shots, and he had to be generally and impeccable. Anything he did even slightly wrong was going to be taken completely out of context. So he made a point later on in his life that this provided him the insight on how to navigate through politics and culture, the cultural warfare that he engaged in his entire life. Some of his tightest lessons came through his football experience. So, he comes out of this as a superstar. So when he arrived in Harlem, he was very well known, and he was very well received by the artistic community. And he did start making a very big name for himself. And very early on, it became clear that he could make a career. He didn't have to stick with law. So he got out of that. And he started performing in a variety of things. And at first, a lot of his earlier performances, I mean, these are just several of the films that he ended up making. I didn't include the stage, the off-Broadway performances, which he even ended up receiving invitations to Europe, to England, to perform early on in 1922, is where that started. So already early, he was transiting across the Atlantic to perform in Europe. A lot of these had regressive stereotyped performances that he ended up playing. In some cases, it was, you know, the encouragement of his wife who said, you know, you have to, like his son, Paul Robeson Jr. made the anecdote that his mother, Paul Robeson's wife, made the point that, you know, sometimes you have to do the garbage to get your name out there to become famous in order to have your message heard. And, you know, whether that's true or not, that's the choice that was made in certain cases in the 20s. So that's why he ends up getting attacked a lot by the Black community for accommodating, in some cases, I mean, it's not very many, but the racist stereotypes. Showboat is one of them. You have a picture there of him as I think it's a Zulu warrior in Sanders of the River, which is a film made by, Alexander Korda. So when he's in England, he was backstabbed by Korda, and Korda was part of the H.G. Wells Fabian Society networks, and a lot of the H.G. Wells movies, like Things to Come and the Mars Attacks movie and other things, pretty much everything H.G. Wells is putting out there is predictive programming in his fiction novels are being turned into movies, and Korda and his brother are the two who are always directing these things. So Korda is doing this one and promised him that this would be an empowering image for a Black person. another co-star in that movie was Jomo Kenyatta, who ends up becoming one of the founding fathers of Kenya, one of the early Pan-Africanists. Now, both Kenyatta and Robeson, who are friends at this time, are betrayed when they discover that in final production, it is a complete apologetic movie for the white man's burden in the British Empire. And they are portrayed in the most racist manner. Other movies like Showboat, again, it's not that bad, but still not the best. However, later on in his film career, he actually succeeds, and he becomes, by this time in the 30s, so this period that we're in right now is from 1922 to 1937, in that period of growth. He ends up producing films that actually have a very empowered, strong African-American lead, like Jericho, Song of Freedom. There in the other side, you have Proud Valley, which make him an international celebrity. So he is the first, at a lot of things, but he becomes the first international film superstar who is Black, and the first who portrays somebody who is Black not in a secondary weak role or a subservient slave role, or, you know, somebody who's carrying bags in a hotel or a servant, which is usually what the Black image had to be in those days of the 20s and 30s. But he actually had empowering lead roles. That's very important. I would just say earlier on, I brought up Korda and the Fabian Society when he was in England, and he stayed in England. He was moving back and forth up until 1926, 27. And then he moves there with his wife and stays there from 27 all the way till 1937. That's his mostly permanent residence. He still does work in America, but his home is mostly in Britain, in London at that time. And he's meeting all of these, I brought up Kenyatta. He's meeting also, Ezekwe from Nigeria, the leader of the Pan-African movement of Nigeria, who becomes the first real president. Jawaharlal Nehru, while studying in London, becomes a close friend of Robeson. The best artists and poets and political leaders from Africa and from India and from Asia who are studying in London. This guy is just befriending everybody. And these become lifelong friendships. They're not superficial things, which we'll come back later. he's also, and he says he discovers that while he's in London, that it's there that he discovers that he's actually an African. So he becomes, he finds himself just finding himself just talking to these people who are studying at the London School of Economics at Oxford and other things from Africa and from Asia, as well as dock workers, people who are, you know, Britain is still a maritime empire. So you have people who are constantly moving around the world, coming through London from all parts of the world. And he's just talking and conversing with everybody. And he becomes much more aware of the true nature of his culture and of his roots. he starts studying. He has, for the first time, access to languages and programs at the London School of Economics Oriental College. So he starts taking courses in language, and he masters Swahili. He's studying Chinese. He studies Arabic. He ends up folding that into Chinese, Russian, German, Italian, Spanish, Yiddish. He ends up learning Yiddish, several Slavic languages he ends up learning, including Czechoslovakian. He speaks Polish. He ends up, by all counts, there's about 20 languages by the 1960s that he can speak and converse in, and 12 of them fluently. And we'll talk a little bit more about this after. It's just phenomenal, though, because he's coming at it not to learn the language. He's coming at it with a higher responsibility and spiritual mindset, which is, I think, an important aspect to how he's able to absorb all of these different cultures into himself, because he really has a sense of responsibility as being the bridge for a new age of man. So as I said, he's the first, I didn't mention this. So while he's there, the Fabian Society, people like H.G. Wells, like George Bernard Shaw, these other terrible eugenicists who are, you know, nominally utilizing an image of socialism to try to attract, through the London School of Economics, they want to attract young talent from around the world and give them a specific brainwashing, I guess you could call it, or narrative on how to look at the world that would be compatible with an imperial world structure. That was how sort of the empire managed their cultural war, and which ideas would be permissible in the colonies. You found talent, you found ways to bring that talent from the colonies into the capital, give them a special, education, and then once approved of, they're deployed back. Now, that's limited. So the Fabian Society was the socialist branch of a lot of these elites that wanted to attract people into a sort of Marxist narrative of history and political economy that would blind them to the actual principal dynamics of history. Now, this was unsuccessful in many cases, but this is what they tried to do. And they tried really hard to seduce Robeson. And I think that Robeson's got an open mind. You know, he's willing to talk to everybody, but he picks up on what they're doing pretty early on. And I think his being backstabbed by Korda was the final blow, where he was like, no, this is a trap. And he, as well as a lot of other independence leaders, I think came in various ways to this recognition during their time, that there's a legitimate socialism, and then you have like this scientific dictatorship socialism with a managerial elite at the top that's a fake. And the more legitimate socialism just simply means we believe in morality for that morality must govern the distribution and production of goods, that, you know, that justice should be something that defines your economy as well as your legal system. And in that sense, you could say that the founding fathers like Alexander Hamilton and Washington were socialist, if you take it from that standpoint. It doesn't mean Marxist necessarily. So that's just something I wanted to throw out there. So, but on, while he's elevating the archetype of a strong black figure in cinema, the thing he's taking greatest pride for is actually his work reviving Shakespeare. And this is another interesting first, because believe it or not, in 1930, he goes to America for several months to perform Shakespeare's Othello, the story of the black, the Moor from Africa, who was a former slave himself, who's liberated and ends up becoming a general for the Venetian Maritime Empire, and a successful general at that, who does a lot of, has a lot of victories for the state and ends up a hero in his society, and to the point that he marries a young, beautiful, adoring woman named Desdemona, who in this performance in 1930 is played by Peggy Ashcroft. Now, Robeson goes back to this performance in two other occasions in his life, during World War II, and again, he performs it in 1958 in London in Stratford. And he's constantly, I mean, he sees this as in a very, from a much higher standpoint than most performers who play Othello. Now, Robeson recognizes in Shakespeare, and he writes about this and speaks about this a lot, you can see the videos where he talks about his view of Shakespeare, that this is not just a romance play or a romance tragedy. For those who don't know, in the case of Othello, Shakespeare develops the story around how not only does he have this wonderful love and relationship with this woman, but there's also a lot of stigma. You know, the father, the family of Desdemona are obviously not happy that she's marrying somebody of African descent. You know, even in spite of the fact that he's a hero militarily, it's still, it's a big insecurity for him that he's an outsider within Venice, and it's a big point of weakness within his heart, this insecurity, this stigma, and a figure who plays a very vicious little man named Iago. You essentially, and you have to read the play or even watch the Verdi rendition of this into opera to really get the sense of it. But Iago is a figure who really represents exactly what Venice does to every nation that they come into contact with while they are the world empire. Before Venice, before the oligarchy of that for hundreds of years ran Venice, migrated its base of operations to England during the Glorious Revolution. But Iago is just whispering in everyone's ear. Iago is just a vicious character, and he exploits Othello's insecurities. And he does it in a way that awakens jealousies that maybe Iago's best friend, Cassio, is actually having an affair with Desdemona, which is unfounded. It's not true. Cassio's totally loyal to Othello, as is Desdemona. But Iago's such a master at manipulation and reading people and reading their weaknesses and exploiting those weaknesses that he's able to induce Cassio into all sorts of self-destructive modes of behavior that seem to prove in Othello's mind that this is true, that he is having an affair with my wife. And Iago's just whispering in everybody's ear individually and inducing them to all act against their own interest and against reality to the point that, well, watch the play, but it doesn't end well. It is a tragedy. It's called a tragedy for a reason. But there's something that Robeson has a problem with, the fact that most actors and directors of the day treated it too much on the basis of romance and jealousy and not enough on the basis of recognizing the either the revolutionary character of Shakespeare, which Robeson is clear on. And Robeson even makes the point that Shakespeare is portraying the story at a period which is between the medieval period and the Renaissance period. It's the transition between these two ages. And he sees very much parallels in his own age that he's living in. And anyway, there's more to be said about this. So he wins accolades in spite of the fact that he obviously gets a lot of death threats. When you have a black lead kissing a white woman in the stages of any place in the United States in those days is very controversial. So both Peggy Ashcroft gets tons of death threats. So does Paul Robeson, but they continue on. The point of interest here is that even though Othello is written for obviously it's a black character, it had never been performed by a black artist in American history until Paul Robeson. It was the very first time in American history that this happens. Just shocking, eh? Alana, I got somebody messaging something. No, it doesn't matter. So before that, everyone playing Othello, as you can imagine, were pretty much white people who would paint their faces with charcoal. It was really regressive. And later on, when he does this again in Europe, he's the first black actor to do it there since one or two actors in the 19th century had done it who were black. But it's really quite astounding. So not only is he the first, this is one of the many firsts, but he's also the first to do something else, which is extraordinary around the same time. So I mentioned, he arrives for the first time in London in 1922. He's doing some stage shows. He's not known as a singer at this time, but he's at a party and somebody hears him, and that somebody is named Lawrence Brown, who's a pianist. He's at the same party. He is one of the closest friends of Roland Hayes, who worked with Roland Hayes, the great African-American spiritualist, for almost 15 years. They were a duo. Roland Hayes really broke so many barriers. He even performed that very year, 1922, in front of the King of England. They stop working together. I'm not too sure the story there, but they stop working together. Roland Hayes is really reviving he's creating a new school. He's advancing the school of American spirituals to give, to empower and enrich the African-American community that even though they had achieved emancipation on a certain level, politically, culturally, a lot of the same cultural chains that had been created under the degradation of slavery for generations still pursued and were maintained by racist institutional forces in America. So there was not an elevated culture. And so Roland Hayes, he's a tenor. His music is just beautiful, even though the recordings sometimes are a little bit choppy on YouTube. He really worked hard to fight against that. And he took a lot of the great African the slave songs that were created, that were generated during the slave years, that also had very strong Christian biblical aspects, feelings, yearnings for freedom that were in there, and infused and uplifted them to a higher artistic caliber. And he sang and worked with this his friend Lawrence Brown. So Lawrence Brown hears Paul Robeson singing at a party in 1922, and they start talking. They begin a friendship, and Lawrence Brown starts organizing Robeson to understand the importance of the spirituals as well as one of several major tools to elevate his people. So in 1925, Lawrence Brown comes to America with Robeson, and they start working on a series of renditions of these spirituals, including Go Down Moses, there's so many. So anyway, there's a couple of pictures of both of them in action right now. And in, I think it's April 1925. Yeah, April 19th, 1925, there's the first all African-American spiritual. I mean, they call it Negro spiritual. I feel weird saying the word, but whatever. They call it Negro. So it's the world's first Negro spiritual concert with only the spirituals performed. They didn't splice it in with other things. It was just that was performed by these two figures in Greenwich Village to a packed sold out concert hall. And there were people waiting outside to get in, couldn't get in. They had 16 encores. And up until then, it was assumed that you couldn't do these things. And a lot of black people didn't want to have anything to do with them because these songs, they were basically, they were too reflective of memories of slavery, that there were people alive in those days who were still slaves, right? And it was a little bit too painful to think about. They wanted to move away from that. So this was something that nobody wanted to do. And by them doing it and doing it in a way that conveyed such dignity and spiritual strength, that it was it created a new movement, which people like Marian Anderson amplified, and many other singers too. Robeson said something important. His insight into folk songs, he said, folk songs are in fact, and this includes both the Negro spirituals, but he looked for this in every culture that he came into contact with. So he says that folk songs are in fact a poetic expression of a people's innermost nature, of the distinctive and multifaceted condition of its life and culture. The folk songs reflected a spiritual force. They reflected the wrath and protest against the enslavers and the aspirations to freedom and happiness. So there's something there that was just uncontrived, right? It just, it came from a deeper soulful place. And if you really want to get the soul of a whole people, their folk songs were the place to go, which is why also when he studied, when he prepared for his performances of Shakespeare as well, he studied Chaucer, he studied ancient Old English, medieval English, and he studied English folk songs. He studied also Venetian songs. He studied African songs. He studied Arabic. He studied African languages in order to get into the character of Othello and the whole spiritual climate of the age of multiple cultures coming into contact, which is what was happening with the characters who were more archetypes of their societies. another thing that I think is value, this is a quote from later on of Robeson speaking in Czechoslovakia after giving a concert. Much of it was in the Czech language, talking about Dvorak and the great composer who was a student of Brahms. And he says to them and describes, and this is stuff he learned directly from Lawrence Brown, where he says, Dvorak came to our land and heard the beautiful songs of my folk, and how, and he pointed out to us in America that here was the basis of a great musical art, springing from a people who had been torn from Africa and brought in slavery to the lands of America. This great composer came here and pointed out that this was the base and could be the base of great music, and proved it by a great symphony and by string quartets. His influence still has great importance on America today. Something I didn't mention is that, yeah, this whole movement to revive and amplify the African-American spirituals was actually instigated by Dvorak, who ended up recruiting a generation of freed slaves who were singers to take this to their people and to evolve it into a new high art. So this is something, again, very important as a lesson on how to think about the cultural emancipation of a people. How do you give them the tools that they don't have to access potentials within themselves that they didn't know that they even had? So that's one thing. And Dvorak was very clear on that. So here I would like to do something. I'm going to stop one share. And we're going to listen to a piece of music. I mean, I had to be very selective in choosing which music I wanted to perform here that would give people examples of the essence of what Robeson is doing. So here's one example of the sort of spiritual I'm talking about, and make sure that your sound is up. Let's try.
When Israel was in Egypt's land, pressed so hard they could not stand, let my people go. Go down, Moses, way down in Egypt's land. Tell all Pharaoh to let spake the Lord upon Moses, said, let my people go. If not, I'll smite your firstborn dead. Let my people go. Go down, Moses, way down. Thank you.
Okay, so that did not sound like a very disempowering song. Now, has everybody here already heard Paul Robeson sing? Was this the first time for anybody? Okay, yeah, so I was just told, and Cynthia, you're allowed to be off of mute if you want, but somebody had written in the chat that they didn't know that Go Down Moses was written by him, and it wasn't written by him, though he did sing it. I will be including a lot of examples. I'll send a playlist out to people so that they can really immerse themselves in a lot of his other spirituals, but I just want to take little selections here and there from different parts of his life. So that's the one selection I'm choosing for the spiritual component. Just to get a sense, during this time as well, as he's this is the 1920s and 30s, I picked one quote just to get across the universality of his thinking. He's generating new insights into the evolution of culture and of languages and of music. And he's looking at, he has a theory, which I think more reasonable, it's like a potent version of Noam Chomsky's universal language theory, or universal grammar, where, you know, Chomsky and these reductionists are all looking for like, what is the universal root of languages based on their, breaking down language into semantics, into grunts and girdles, and impulses. It's very binary. Whereas Robeson's starting from the standpoint of music, musicality, and he has a whole theory of modes of fifths and other things that are interesting. When you listen to languages just speak naturally and sing naturally, there's certain intervals that he discovers across the board that and this one quote exemplifies one aspect of his deeper thinking, where he writes, alongside the towering achievements of the cultures of ancient Greece and China, there stood the culture of Africa, unseen and denied by the imperialist looters of Africa's material wealth. And I came to learn of the remarkable kinship between African and Chinese culture. I have long had a deep and abiding interest in the cultural relations of Africa, Asia and Africa. Living evidence of the ancient kinship of Africa and Asia is seen in the language structures, in the arts and philosophies of the two continents. And we're going to have a little sample of how he's thinking about that in a second. So unfortunately, many of his early recordings of him speaking and singing are not easily available on the internet. It's an unfortunate thing, and I think there might be malicious intentions perhaps that have kept a lot of his, because he wrote prolifically, spoke prolifically, recorded prolifically, and again, it's incredible how little of it is available before the 1940s, and especially in the 30s and 20s. Very difficult. So here's an encapsulation of some of these ideas in a 1958 performance at Carnegie Hall, where you could just see how he's putting into words this idea.
I'm about to do one that comes from a great tradition, which in our own life is the tradition of the colored preacher. My father was a preacher. And when he felt very happy, he'd start what you call moving about. And as James Weldon Johnson says, from that has grown much of the art that we listen to in any phase of our Negro life. The Negro spirituals, for example. Might have a preacher might have said, oh, the spirit say, I want you for to go down dead easy. I want you to go down dead easy and bring my spirit home. Go down, preach my glory and my mighty name. I want you to go down, I want you to go down and bring my servant home. Say, I want you, and you can sing it. It goes into a song. From the chanting speech of the Negro preacher, it becomes a great chant. And in searching for this and following this back, we went back in Africa and found these same forms that were in the African religious festivals.
Chapalapatapatayi, chapalapatayi, chapalapatapatayi, chapalapatayi, zungum zungu wachine, zungum zungu wachine, chapalapatapatayi, chapalapatayi, slati vatsklabe, vive do chesky zemi. Svati Vatsklave, vive do česky země. Chapalapatapatayi. One is from the, about the, between the 13th and 15th centuries, or the early centuries, of the Czech plain chant, which preceded the Lutheran chorale and was a part of the whole Gregorian chant. And interesting to find in East Africa and in Africa, melodies and a form which were very close to these forms of the early church of the Middle Ages. Why was this so? Because the Abyssinian church and the church of the Sudan were a part of the eastern churches of Byzantium. And so they too had a music quite comparable to the music of the Near East and to the music of the next one I shall sing, one Hasidic chant of Rabbi Levi Isaac of Berdichev.
And so this is, even though this is 1958, he's had these thoughts, these concepts all the way back to the 1920s when he was in Europe. And something that to point out, a lot of this was influenced by his friendship with W.E.B. Du Bois, who was the one of the co-founders of the NAACP. Earlier on, his father was more on the side of Booker T. Washington's approach. Washington was also, in many ways, a great figure for the emancipation of Black people, and he founded this Tuskegee Institute. But Robeson decided a little bit later on that that's maybe not the best approach by itself, where Booker T. Washington was saying it will be by purely excelling in every field that segregation will be overcome. But there's no need to actually resist anything. just be the best that you can be. And that has merit. And as you could see from Robeson's life so far, he exemplified that perfectly, as did his father. However, and W.E. Du Bois is like, well, actually, maybe we need to challenge, evil laws as well. We don't just want to assume that they're going to go away by themselves, but also be the best that you can be. So he ended up becoming very influenced. And W.E. Du Bois also had a view of an African Renaissance that I think needs to be more fully explored. He had a great devotion to Africa that I think is underestimated. But so their lifelong friendship was very important in Robeson's development of his ideas, and the idea of like chords of fifths that permeate the African songs, folk songs, as well as many of the Asian folk songs. And you would see these as well in many of the rhythms and chords in the slave songs, because, you know, keep in mind, I mean, these were people who were brought from their cultures in Africa to the Americas, to the Caribbeans, and to South America, and to the US. And a lot of the rhythms, a lot of the chords, these things are still echoed and reflected in the organic choices of musical composition that they would come up with. So he's like, these are things that you cannot ignore. If you're a linguist, if you're an anthropologist, if you're a musician, you have to pay attention to all of these things, like Dvorak did, which is a whole discussion unto itself. I just wanted to show quickly here, he's loved because of this approach. He sets himself on becoming a sort of cultural Renaissance ambassador for the world, and exemplifies just the best of what America could have ever have been. And this is a picture of him in Moscow in 1949. The first time he goes to Moscow, however, I know I'm still in the 1922 to 1937 chapter or act of his life, was 1934. He's invited there because there's Eisenstein, the great Russian director Sergei Eisenstein invites him, they're friends. And Eisenstein is preparing a film on Toussaint Louverture, in Russia, the great Haitian revolutionary. And, Robeson loves the idea, and they were humoring the idea of him potentially playing L'Ouverture. And Jerry actually gave a wonderful class on L'Ouverture, as well as wrote a wonderful essay on our Canadian Patriot site and on the Rising Tide site, which I'll also include in the link to this video. Now, that film never ends up becoming a reality. However, he discovers in Russia something just amazing, that it's the only country that they have had in their new constitution. And criticize what you may about the Bolshevik Revolution. I mean, there's a lot to criticize. But they did have a constitution that for the first time, they banned segregation and racism in the constitution that had never been done in a country before overtly. He also felt no racism. He said it's the first time being in Russia that he felt like a full human being. That's a big deal. It helped as well that he eloquently spoke Russian and he knew their folk songs. He knew their wonderfully. So he was just adored. Same thing everywhere he goes. You have just these pictures of crowds loving him from all over Europe, all over Asia. And I mean, they just see that he is them. Okay, we are now going to listen to... I had a choice between two Russian folk songs, Volga Boatman and Song of the Plains. I only have so much time, so I picked Song of the Plains. It's a... well, you'll see. I'll just play it. And he always tends to, not always, but he usually will do an English translation in song form and then... whatever language he's singing in.
Open field, rolling plain, wide open prairie. Heroes go riding across the prairie. Yes, with the Red Army go the heroes. Oh, maidens fair. Upon the road we follow, far and away the road goes winding. Look and see how merrily the road goes. Far and away the road goes winding. Look and see how merrily the road goes. Maidens, wipe away the teardrops. Now let's all sing together louder. Sing with us our battle song united. Polushka, Polya, the Polushka, Shiroka, Polya, Yedu, the Popol, you get oi. Ekta, Krasny Army, get oi. Колхозы, наши девушки колхозы, эх, там молодые наши села. Эх, 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 наши девушки колхозы, эх, там молодые наши села. Эх, Полюшка, 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 широка поле, едут и по полю герои, экта Красной Армии герои. Эх, rolling green open field, rolling plain wide open prairie, heroes go riding across the prairie, yes, with the Red Army go the heroes.
Now, unfortunately, I'm not going to play Volga Boatman, which is also wonderful just because there are other songs that I want to get through. But it's just incredible that this man is able to synthesize languages and music into his soul and then convey it in such a brilliant way. It's, again, so uncontrived. Nothing he's doing, even though he's increasingly becoming the most paid, highest earning performer in the world at this time, he's donating most of it to causes, and he's doing nothing for money or for fame. There's a higher spiritual purpose to all of this that's very important in his life. Now, during this period in the 30s, this is 1934, he's singing in Russia, he's making allies, friends, and he's really coming into a new sense of awareness of the anti-fascist, anti-colonial fight, that it's one, two sides of the same coin. So the anti-racism, the anti-segregation fight that he's always led, the fight for cultural emancipation, but now also increasingly, as in the 30s, you see the emergence of very powerful forms of fascism in Germany, in France, increasingly in Italy and in Spain. It's coming on fast. It's coming on in Europe too, in England as well. It's coming on in America with Roosevelt's enemies. In the American Liberty League and other, fascist sympathizing groups allied to Wall Street. We have it in Canada. We have it in Quebec under Adrian Arcand, the Quebec Nazi who came close to taking total power. We have it in Ottawa with its own thing. So we have this all over the world as like a something funded by a lot of financial elites and something which is completely antithetical to any idea or aspiration of freedom, of democracy, of freedom of conscience of the individual. And Robeson just quickly takes sides, as he says, from that beginning quote in Spain, or to the Spanish movement. Now, he ends up going to Spain in 1938. And he... this is a picture of him with some of the Republican resistance movements who are getting most of their support. That's a picture of some of the Spanish resistance fighters, the Republicans. Keep in mind, so what had happened in Spain in 1935 was you had an election victory of an anti-fascist government, and the German, in Germany and Berlin, you had the 1936 Olympics that were coming up. This government had boycotted because of, they were just anti-fascist. So they boycotted the Olympics. They were preparing an anti-Olympic Olympics in Barcelona in 1936. But a long-awaited coup was in the works, being supported by Hitler, by Mussolini, who all wanted Franco to come out on top. And that's what happened. So a major civil war broke out during this coup that was started in North Africa and Morocco, and then it spread immediately with four insurgent generals who shot the first shots to start this process. And for several years, a major fight against the fascists was waged. And like I said, there's an African-American in that picture. You had patriotic people from Canada, things like the Louis Papineau Brigade fought in Spain, patriots in America, unionists. A lot of their material and financial support was coming from Russia at the time. And Robeson, I mean, he definitely threw in his hat early on. Now, he sang to these fighters. And I'm going to play one of the most powerful resistance songs of the time that he sang in Spanish, called The Four Insurgent Generals.
The four insurgent generals, the four insurgent generals, the four insurgent generals, mamita mia, 'tis true they betrayed you, 'tis true they betrayed you. One Christmas whole evening, one Christmas whole evening, one Christmas whole evening, mamita mia, they'll all be hanging, they'll all be hanging. Madrid, your tears of sorrow, Madrid, your tears of sorrow, Madrid, your tears of sorrow, mamita mia, we shall avenge them, we shall avenge them. Los cuatro generales, los cuatro generales, los cuatro generales, mamita mía, que se han nadado, que se han nadado. Para la noche buena, para la noche buena, para la noche buena, mamita mía, serán arcados, serán arcados.
So he described in his autobiography of his experience in Spain on his way back before going returning to America. He said that I sang with my whole heart and soul for these gallant fighters on the International Brigade. A warm feeling for my homeland grew within me as I met the men of the Abraham Lincoln Battalion. My heart was filled with admiration and love for these white Americans. And there was a great sense of pride in my own people when I saw that there were Negroes too in the ranks of the Lincoln men in Spain. Now, Robeson returns at this point. Someone's trying to get in. So Robeson returns to America in 1938, where he ends up he's celebrated. He's probably the most loved by Americans during this period between 1937 and 45 during the fight against fascism. And especially after 1941, when America enters, he's really, and he is a, welcome somebody. Bill, welcome to the class. I'm just going to put you on mute. Okay. Okay. All right. So he is, he's now working on overtime to win the war in any way possible. He, as I said before, at this point, he's become the highest paid performer. Some of his concerts are garnering $2,000 a ticket. All of it, the majority of it is going towards winning the war and various causes. He ends up also during this time, so he's selling war bonds, he's performing American patriotic songs, he's fighting really valiantly for Franklin Roosevelt, who he recognizes is an anti-fascist, anti-colonialist, a very rare thing in the American upper level establishment during the early 20th century, and also Roosevelt's vice president takes a big part of his life at a certain point, who I'm going to devote a bit more time to. He ends up also performing Othello during this time for the second time. And he makes the point this time to study Othello and perform it, which he sees as part of the overarching emancipation effort during the war in 1942 to 43. He makes a point to study it now and rehearse it and perform it in four different languages. So he studies it in French, he learns Othello in German, as well as in Russian and in Yiddish, each one to get a different aspect of the feeling, what he needed to tap into. The French, because the language is a very romantic language, it's a very, very musical language. German, because there's a certain, he's performing a military general, and there has to be a certain structure and to the demeanor of Othello as a military general. in Russian because there's a certain quality of the language, a certain playfulness to the language that he just finds useful for that play. And then also in Yiddish, because it's a very serious play. And he makes the point that you got to find a way to still stay in a, there's a lot of humor in the Yiddish language, and you have to sort of stay above the darkness a little bit. So that's just an interesting thing that he does. But he's also during this time rallying for union workers as well, for their rights. And during this time, he comes into contact in 1940 with a young Chinese revolutionary named Liu Liang Mo. And he's a composer and a musician. And he's somebody who was working with the YMCA in Shanghai during the resistance against the Japanese aggression. Robeson had already delivered several speeches and songs to concerts in Europe, as well as in America, in support of the Chinese fight against fascism in the Pacific coast. And at one point, Madame Sun Yat-sen really likes Paul Robeson, let's just say that. And so this young musician takes a bunch of Chinese resistance songs, folk songs and resistance songs, and he needs broader international support. So he goes to America with all of these songs in hand, and he's trying to find a way to help broaden the awareness of the fight and the plight of the Chinese. It wasn't fully understood, you know, in the late 30s, in most American minds, what the war is about. It took a lot of effort to really educate people. That's what Frank Capra's movies, Why We Fight, that's why they were created, was to bring an understanding that this is not some abstract thing happening on the other side of the world. This is something that implicates you too, you know? Fascism is not just gonna stay isolated out of America's existence. So Robeson, very quickly, this young man, Liu Liang Mo, comes into contact with Robeson. One of his friends encounters him, and he gets on the phone with Robeson, and Robeson's like, "You just came from China here with music? Yeah, let's meet." And so like the next day, Robeson is being introduced to all of these Chinese resistance songs. And he asked him to sing the famous March of the Volunteers twice. And this is a song composed in 1935 by Ni Er. It still hadn't, I mean, today it's known as China's national anthem. At that time, it wasn't. It was just a resistance song. It's a beautiful song. And Paul Robeson, immediately, he's about to give a concert in about 2 weeks' time. It's not planned that he's going to do this. So he gives the concert, and then by the end of the concert, he says, "I've got another song to play." And he performs now the March of the Volunteers. It's a huge acclaim. Everyone's bawled over. Most Americans hadn't heard any Chinese songs, let alone Chinese revolutionary songs. And it's a hit. And a couple of weeks after that, in 1941, he records a professional record performing, you know, as a single, the March of the Volunteers. And the chorus in the background that you're going to come to hear, I'm going to play it, is all of the Chinese New York laundry workers that were organized by Liu Liang Mo to perform and to sing. So this is a quick snapshot of one of Robeson's performances of this. Oops. Let me just go to a new share. What's up? And keep in mind also,
this is a song.
Before I say anything else, all of the proceeds for this song, which sold wonderfully internationally, all went to help the fight against the Japanese. And Madame Sun Yat-sen wrote an intro to it as well. It was a big hit, and this catapulted the awareness of the fight into the psyche of the zeitgeist really well. And Frank Capra, it was brought to his attention. He used that for his segment on China in the Why We Fight series.
Get the blue button. Get the blue button.
Oh, it's okay. I do this. I have to do this every time?
No, you can do it now.
Oh, I thought I did it before.
There you go.
All right.
What's the blue?
This is a song born in the struggle of the brave Chinese people. It begins, "Chi Lai. Arise, you who refuse to be bond slaves," and ends, "Chen Jing, march on." Chi Lai, Wu Zhuan Zong Lu Di Ran Man, Ba Wo Men
chong wo men xing di chang chong chong hua ming fu dao liao sui wei xian di shi hao mei ge ren bei bo zhe fa qiu zui hao di hao chang qi lai qi lai qi lai wo men wan chong yi xing mao zhe di shuan di bao huo 前进，冒着敌方的炮火，前进，前进，前进，进 ！Arise, you refuse to be bond slaves. Let's stand up and fight for liberty and true democracy. All our world is facing the chains of the tyrant. Everyone who works for freedom is now crying. Arise, arise, arise. All of us with one heart, with the torch of freedom, march on. With the torch of freedom, march on, march on, march on and on. 起来，不由俺所努力的人们，把我们的血肉塑成我们心的长城。中华民族到了最危险的时候。 每个人被迫着发出最好的号声，起来，起来，起来！我们顽强一心，冒着敌方的炮火，前进，冒着敌方的炮火，前进，前进，前进，前进。
I'm just going to stop it there because we have still quite a bit to go through. But since we're at it, during this time as well, this is going to be the last song I think that I'm going to perform or have Robeson perform. There's a beautiful Yiddish song that he performed during the course of World War II and then even afterwards. This is a 1949 performance of it. It's the Warsaw Ghetto Uprising. It's a song in praise of the valiant fight in Poland when the Nazis came in and you had a gigantic Polish resistance movement and in Warsaw where a lot of the Jews were concentrated. And it's just an incredibly passionate period of history. And this wonderful musical rendition was made, which Robeson really internalized. Like I said, he actually learned Yiddish. He spoke it fluently. So I'm just going to play that. Now, again, this is the 1949 concert. At this point, some things are going awry in the Soviet Union. And Robeson is sort of, he never came out speaking against the Soviet Union because he always saw that there was a broader fight against global imperialism that was more useful to focus on and chose to not really make an issue out of a lot of the wrongs that were happening in under Stalin. However, and so he sort of made this as a bit of a cultural intervention on a certain way, but that's another story. So here's the song.
Arshavi.
Du gehst dem letzten Wege, wenn Himmeln bleien, verstellen bläue Tege, weil kommen wird noch unser Eus gebänkte Schau, uns wird abbeugt und unser Trott mir sein in Do, weil kommen wird noch unser Eus gebänkte Schau, uns wird abbeugt und unser Trott mir sein in Do. Palmenland bis Weidenland von Schnee. Wir seien in da mit unser Pein, mit unser Weh. Und wenn gefallen, ist er spritzt von unser Blut, wird noch ersprotzt von unser Geburt, unser Mut. Und wenn gefallen, ist er spritzt von unser Blut, wird noch ersprotzt von unser Geburt, unser Mut. Geschrieben ist das Lied mit Bluten, nicht mit Blei. Es ist nicht ein Lied von Zimmervogel auf der Frei. Nos hat ein Volk zwischen Fallen, die gewinnt.
das Lied gesungen mit einer Gammes in die Hand. Das hat der Volk zwischen Fahlen die Gewand. Das Lied gesungen mit einer Gammes in die Hand.
Powerful stuff. So, toward the end of the war, in 1944, actually, this is an organization that was created in the early 40s by Robeson. It's something that I was surprised to find out about. It had endured from 1941 when it was founded all the way until 1955 when it was shut down under McCarthyism. The Council on African Affairs, it had international support. I mean, this thing was a force, and I underestimated how much it, I mean, many of the Pan-African leaders, the people who would emerge as the leaders of the Pan-African movement, including especially Kwame Nkrumah of Ghana, who was were all members of this. Their strategy, their battle plans that they later put into action during the 1950s were very much influenced by the Council on African Affairs. Robeson was the chairman. W.E.B. Du Bois was the vice chairman. And that's Du Bois and that's Robeson right there. In their mandate in 1944, just as it was becoming clear that the war, there was a chance that the war could be put down, but the reality of the this deep state structure in America that was aiming to take over control was emerging. This whole Anglo-American special relationship crowd was pushing hard, and Robeson and his colleagues could very much foresee where this was going to go, and they intervened on that. In the Council on African Affairs, in this mandate, it specifies several things that I just pulled out. There's more to it. I should move this. That to give concrete help to the struggle of the African masses, to disseminate accurate information concerning Africa and its people, in that to wake up Americans to what is happening in Africa, the one continent where undisguised colonial slavery is still practiced. Unfortunately, this is 1944 and it's not that different today. To influence the adoption of governmental policies designed to promote their advancement in freedom and preserve international peace, to smash the iron curtain of secrecy and double talk surrounding the schemes for imperialist exploitation of Africa and its people, to prevent American loans and guns from being used to crush the freedom struggle of Africans and other subject peoples, to strengthen the allegiance of progressive Americans, black and white, with the peoples of Africa and other lands in the struggle for world peace and freedom. So things are moving in a certain direction at this time, right? We have Franklin Roosevelt is still alive. There's still a view of breaking colonialism forever. Roosevelt very much represents that view, as does Henry Wallace, his vice president, as does Wendell Willkie, and many others. Harry Dexter White. I mean, there's a whole crowd of anti-imperialists who are high level in the American establishment fighting to ensure that America can export the New Deal, example of the 1930s, to other countries as a way to help them stand on their own two feet and have sovereignty, real economic sovereignty. This is completely in opposition to the Rhodes Scholar British crowd that had long penetrated into the State Department and other branches of U.S. foreign policy, of American foreign policy. So Robeson has to deal with a new reality when Roosevelt dies in April 12, 1945. And all of his worst fears become realized increasingly. So this next act deals with this small period, this dense period from 1945 to 49, which I called Wallace and the Fight to Save the Soul of America. Now, that's a few pictures of Robeson during this period. When I say Wallace, I've mentioned him a few times. That's Wallace while he was still vice president under a healthier FDR.
FDR's health degenerated very quickly after he was just elected into his fourth term. And at that point, Wallace had been jettisoned with a bit of a political coup in favor of a more Wall Street British friendly puppet named Harry Truman. In January 1945, Wallace was ousted. Truman was brought in, ensuring that if anything were to happen to FDR, an early death, that Truman would become president, which is what happened. And immediately, that Iron Curtain came down fast under Churchill's Iron Curtain speech. Bombs were unnecessarily dropped, nuclear bombs onto Japan, and a Anglo-American special relationship was set into motion. Wallace, it's shocking to read some of his speeches and his writings. While he was still vice president, he wrote in 1944 in a New York Times article warning of the thing that Robeson was warning of, saying that fascism in the post-war inevitably will push steadily for Anglo-Saxon imperialism and eventually for war with Russia. Already American fascists are talking and writing about this conflict and using it as an excuse for their internal hatreds and intolerances towards certain races, creeds, and classes. He's also referring in this case to the rise of the KKK and the return of the Jim Crow laws in the post-war age, which were all being supported by the same intelligence operatives in the FBI and the State Department and the CIA who wanted colonialism abroad. They also wanted racism within. It's two sides of the same coin. And Abraham Lincoln knew this. When you read Lincoln's speeches on his understanding that the divine right of kings and the system of hereditary power as well as slavery is all one thing, just different sides of it. It shouldn't be compartmentalized. Wallace did not. Wallace was fired because he came out with the following quote, saying Soviet Asia mission, where he's calling for friendship with Russia and China. Wallace wrote in 1946, he'd already been downgraded to the Commerce Secretary out of the vice president. But he hadn't been ousted yet, but he wrote this saying, before the blood of our boys is scarcely dry on the field of battle, these enemies of peace try to lay the foundations for World War III. These people must not succeed in their foul enterprise. We must offset their poison by following the policies of Roosevelt and cultivating the friendship of Russia in peace as well as in war. I'm just going to quickly show. Now, he's fired very promptly after this a speech calling for friendship with Russia. Wallace is ousted, he's canned, and Robeson comes out in a major speech in New York saying, we are shocked by the forced resignation of Wallace. We join with the overwhelming majority of Americans who want peace and democracy for this country and the world in fully supporting Wallace's criticism. We cannot avoid the painful conclusion that Truman's actions represents a complete capitulation to the reactionary minority in our country who seek world domination. Now that's Robeson's comments on Wallace being canned. Now, I'll just point out here. So I had a picture here of Robeson and Wallace in 1948. They're very closely allied. When Wallace announces in 1947, his policy to run for the presidency in the 48 elections as a third party progressive party candidate. Robeson becomes one of his key fighters and defenders. He actually doesn't do a lot of singing for this whole year. Robeson pretty much devotes his full-time attention to making everything possible for a Wallace victory, giving thousands of speeches. Radio and live across America. Hold on, somebody's entering here. Okay. So that's just the two of them. Here's just one clip of a Wallace Progressive Party convention. It was a big deal. I mean, this was coming at a point when America was being set to be turned into a marcher lord on behalf of British intelligence. You know, the patriots of Roosevelt's ilk were all either dying prematurely or being expelled from all office by being labeled red commie sympathizers. These were all the people who were the highest level trusted people of FDR. And I'm including here people like Harry Dexter White, the guy who fought John Maynard Keynes in the Bretton Woods and became the first director of the IMF, was a close Roosevelt anti-colonial ally and who died while campaigning for Roosevelt of a heart attack after being grilled under a House of Un-American Activities Committee hearing. Harry Hopkins dies of a heart attack in 46. Wendell Willkie had died already at the end of 44. All of the champions. So Wallace is really the last man standing. And they're fighting. It's not just political figures, but you have also Einstein joining this. Einstein becomes a fighter for a Wallace presidency. so is Charlie Chaplin, you know, like the best figures in science and the arts, just like what Robeson had called for, are all taking the stage of history. One thing I didn't mention here, Robeson has several civil rights movements that he's created, one of which is called the American Crusade Against Lynchings that he set up in 1946. Einstein, Albert Einstein becomes, who he has stayed at Einstein's house, they're close friends there. Einstein is made the vice chairman of Robeson's American Crusade Against Lynching. And he did this because when World War II black veterans were coming back after having risked their lives to fight fascism, they had expected, and rightfully so, to be granted civil rights, like all civil rights equal to white people. And that wasn't happening, especially in the southern states. Lynchings went for a mass spike. The KKK grew in influence, as I said, and over 100 American black servicemen were lynched, died, and Truman did nothing. Robeson had several meetings, and Truman made it very clear that this is not the time that he wants to deal with this, and nothing was going to happen. So Robeson creates this committee, and they organize mass movements all across America to stop lynching and racism more generally. In many ways, this is the at the heart of the civil rights movement that comes later to blossom under Martin Luther King's leadership. He also creates the Civil Rights Congress, which gets behind Wallace. So he has these different movements. The Civil Rights Congress, Robeson is a fierce speaker. That's Wallace behind him right there. I had a really wonderful quote from Civil Rights Congress. Oh yeah, here it is. Sorry. So 1947, this is at the beginning of the Wallace presidential run. He's speaking at his Congress, saying the guarantee that our day of liberation is not far off is that this is a time of colonial liberation. It is a time when the dark men and women of Africa and Asia are pulling off their shackles of exploitation, which have kept them bound for centuries. As they succeed in Asia, and soon you may be sure in Africa, as more than half the world escapes the clutches of the Dulleses, the Rockefellers, and the Firestones, they lend a powerful stimulus to our freedom struggle here at home. So you see the value of what he's doing. Oh yeah, and there's another campaign speech for Wallace. Just a quick thing, there's more speeches that can be found, but this one he just says, either we get along with the communists, jump in the ocean, or blow up the whole world. Saying you cannot get along with communists is like saying you cannot get along with the birds. If anybody continues the New Deal traditions of Franklin Roosevelt, it is Wallace. And it's in the same speech that Robeson characterizes himself as an advanced New Dealer, as an international New Dealer. Literally, he calls it that. So there's an understanding from Wallace and Robeson that the New Deal was not just something isolated for America, but was supposed to be something that liberates all nations of the world with Tennessee Valley-like projects of electrification, of advancement of all countries, of industrial freedom for all countries. So there would be no more cash cropping under the British system. So that's all very clear. That's a picture from, unfortunately, a not so happy Wallace and Robeson when they discovered that they would come. Yeah, the results for the 48 elections were very much not in their favor. Truman ended up winning. There was a lot of FBI harassment and psyops. You know, the American people were being turned very quickly into vicious, paranoid, fear-based tools under the propaganda of the Cold War of those early years. And a lot of people were being thrown in jail for nothing more than simply being either a member of the Communist Party or even just having said things that were sympathetic to the idea of harmony with Russia and China, who were supposed to be our enemies. Roosevelt, Wallace doesn't win. at a New York City speech, this is another little segment of a broader speech that I think is just really good. Robeson says, June 19th, this is 1949, New York. Are these financial big boys America? No, they are the former enemies of Roosevelt. They were the ones who were glad when Roosevelt died. They were the same ones who Roosevelt said were the core of American fascism. They are the allies of the remains of the Hitler entourage. They are the friends of Franco, the living representatives of the Spanish conquistadors who enslaved us and still enslave us in Latin America. They are the ones who hate American democracy, as did the enemies of Jefferson and Lincoln before them. They are no part of America. They are the would-be preservers of world fascism and the enemies of progressive America. So, Robeson doesn't give up, as Wallace kind of takes a bit of a backseat at this point. Robeson just goes full hog. He fights harder than ever during this period, giving speeches abroad, including a speech at the World Peace Congress in Paris, where he basically says that blacks would not fight in a war with the Soviet Union when the country that they are representing is still lynching them and protecting those who are doing the lynching. And the Soviet Union is a country which has put anti-racism legislation into their constitution. He's like, why would we do that? So this all comes to a boil at a very big moment in 1949 in what's called the Peekskill riots. So in August 1949, he is scheduled to give a freedom concert in New York, Peekskill, New York. And before the concert can happen, thousands of KKK and other hardcore right-wing fascists I just call them fascists, but they lit the stage on fire. They were burning crosses. They destroyed all of the instruments, all of the equipment to sabotage the concert, which did get sabotaged. It didn't happen. A few weeks later in September, they move to another location now and try to do the concert again. And again, there's 20,000 people now that arrive for an outdoor concert. A lot of unionists, a lot of just freedom-loving Americans. And they come to listen. Pete Seeger is one of the performers. A lot of really good performers are playing there. And the fascists come down again. That's a clip of one of these state troopers. About 180 state troopers have to go down to try to like keep the mobs at bay. There's 5,000 of them who show up to try to do what they did last time and destroy the concert. What you have there is a picture of a car being overturned in the riots that came after it. And there on the bottom right is a picture of the stage with Robeson in the middle, and he's encircled by 12 volunteer bodyguards from the union movements. Around this perimeter of the whole 20,000 people, there are about 1,000 union workers lock arms together and encircle the entire perimeter as part of the security during the entire concert, which does go down well. The concert unfolds okay. There are two snipers that are discovered in trees waiting to get a clear shot of Robeson and kill him, who luckily are discovered before they see that shot. And they're removed from the trees. After the concert, it gets crazy. I'm just gonna show one little 2-minute clip that I think showcases that. It's from a documentary narrated by Sidney Poitier, which just gets at some of the footage that you have to just sort of see for yourself to appreciate the insanity of the whole thing, the ignorance, pervasive. But here it is.
The reaction to Robeson's speaking out politically in Europe was to erupt in Peekskill, New York. He had scheduled on his return a fourth annual concert for the Civil Rights Congress in Peekskill. However, those who wanted his outspoken voice stilled threatened violence if Robeson sang. Protesters paraded. Despite the threats, on September 4th, 1949, Robeson came to sing. Spectators jeered on the sidelines at the people who came to listen.
There's a group of young boys here yelling at the people stopped in their cars. There are hundreds,
and hundreds of people here, and if there's a serious outbreak, it will be very bad.
Because the concert was ringed with a threat of violence, hundreds of concertgoers volunteered and stood a circle of guard around the audience and around Robeson himself. When the concert was over, the police did little or nothing to avoid a confrontation. The concertgoers were attacked as they left, and a riot developed. 140 people were injured.
The skirmishes are breaking out all over here. The police are fighting the cops. Oh, this is terrible. And they are beating up a Negro. They're clubbing him. Right.
After Peekskill, other cities became fearful. Concerts were canceled. Robeson records were withdrawn from stores. Robeson continued to speak out, and condemnation of the man and his beliefs continued. Unbelievably, even his selection years before as All-American end for Rutgers was wiped from the record. The 1917-1918 College Football Hall of Fame listed the only 10-man All-American team in history. The 11th man, Paul Robeson, was eliminated, erased from the record books.
This is Pete Seeger. I was there too. There were 900 police, deputies, and state troopers at Peekskill. They allowed the mob to form along a four-mile line of road and directed all traffic down this only exit and then stood by watching while the hoodlums threw rocks through the windows of cars and buses. Heads were bashed in, eyes were cut by flying glass, cars were overturned and the people in them dragged out and beaten. And the police stood by and laughed. Hoodlum gangs went on a night-long reign of terror all through Westchester County, clear down to 210th Street and Broadway. Then the police moved. They moved into the picnic grounds to beat up the trade union guard.
Yeah. Pete Seeger made the point, and this is a very good point, that not only do the cops just stand back and laugh, but not a single violent right-winger, KKK, anybody, not a single person got a fine for any of the violence or sending 146 people into the hospital. Not one. The only people who got tickets were, as Pete Seeger said, the actual unionists, the people who were on the receiving end of the punches, people who were trying to speed their cars to get out of there to save their necks, or people who were actually getting tickets for having their car windows broken and driving with a car window broken. A complete travesty. And, you know, as Poitier said in that as well, after this moment, after this thing, all of the media made it sound to the population in general, the mainstream media, it's not just now that it got bad, that it was Robeson's people, the Robesonites, who were the ones who instigated this violence. And immediately 80 concerts that he had planned for that season were all canceled. And there was a complete blacklisting, full hog. Not a single store was allowed to advertise Robeson for fear of all sorts of fines and harassment by the FBI. If you were going to be playing with Robeson, you would not get any jobs and you would be blacklisted. Carnegie Hall wouldn't allow anybody who had touched Robeson to rent Carnegie Hall. The radios couldn't play anything by him. And there was a blackout that lasted for about 10 years. Robeson's revenue collapsed. He went from having earning about $100,000 a year to earning less than $6,000 a year and less even. A lot of his friends had come in to help him. And the only times for that decade that he sang was either at small community centers or in some schools or in some black churches. But that was it. That was it. He was really muffled. And Dulles, John Foster Dulles of the State Department, put down the final acts by revoking his passport in the end of 1949, beginning of 50, which also banned him from being able to even leave the country. There were a couple of countries at that time you didn't need a passport to visit, including Canada and Mexico. And to solve that problem and to ensure that he would not be able to go there either, Harry Truman was more than happy to kick in a presidential decree
to particularly block Robeson's travel to Canada or Mexico. He was in exile in his own land, which is the name of this next act. So the next period of Robeson's life, 1949 to 58. What you see there is a 1952 concert in Canada. Those are Canadians in Vancouver. They're looking over to the American border south with Robeson holding a little monument that's indicative of the boundary, the Canada-US boundary, with 1 foot in Canada, 1 foot in the USA. And there's 30,000 people who gathered for this outdoor concert. Due to lack of time, I cannot play the segment I have of his speech. It's a 13-minute speech, unfortunately. But I will make that available to Canadians, which is just a very, very powerful message. during this time as well, you got to keep in mind, W.E.B. Du Bois was also blacklisted and had very reduced mobility, as was Charlie Chaplin. They couldn't get any jobs anywhere. You had people like Trumbo, the screenwriter, and many others from Hollywood who were patriots, who were human beings, who understood what was happening to America, and were their creative voices were muzzled. And some were even put in jail. I know that Ben Davis, the head of the Communist Party, who was a friend of Robeson, Robeson refused to denounce him. And Robeson was told, you know, if you just denounce Ben Davis, then you'll be fine. He wouldn't do it. He wouldn't give up his friends. And Ben Davis went to prison, as did Alpheus Hunton on the Council of African Affairs, the person who was head of the New Africa Journal, which is a very, very important journal. I wish we could get archival copies, because it seems like this was the official voice of the Africa Council of, that Robeson led. But the editor was a classic scholar, a leading professor who was given 6 months in jail just because, you know. So it was the most unconstitutional time. And a lot of his allies from the NAACP turned their backs on Robeson. They all acquiesced to the Alan Dulles State Department. And people like Jackie Robinson, the baseball player, was threatened and induced to speak out against Robeson publicly and denounce him. Other unions were also induced to denounce Robeson just out of fear. People who he fought for, rights that he fought for, were they chose to ignore it all. So it was a really difficult time in American history, as well as in Robeson's own life, but he persevered. And I think that that's very important. So I think to get a sense of his strength of character and his perseverance, there is a confrontation that he has with the House on Un-American Activities, which this I will play the whole 10-minute piece just to get a sense of his strength, his courage, and his eloquence in the face of this inquisition that had caused so many other people to break down. This is an 11-minute, almost 12-minute hearing, but I think it's worth just playing.
Do I have the privilege of asking who's addressing me?
I'm Richard Arend.
What is your position?
I'm director of the staff. Did you file a passport application in July 2, 1954?
I filed about 25 in the last few months.
In July of 1954, were you requested to submit a non-communist affidavit?
Under no conditions would I think of signing such an affidavit. It is a contradiction of the rights of American citizens.
Are you now a member of the Communist Party?
Oh, please, please, please.
Please answer, will you, Mr. Robeson?
What is the Communist Party? What do you mean by that?
Are you now a member of the Communist Party?
Would you like to come to the ballot box when I vote and take out the ballot and see?
Mr. Chairman, I respectfully suggest the witness be directed to answer the question.
You are directed to answer the question.
I invoke the Fifth Amendment and forget it.
I respectfully suggest the witness be directed to answer the question whether, if he gave us a truthful answer, he would be supplying information which might be used against him in a criminal proceeding.
You are directed to answer, Mr. Robeson.
In the first place, wherever I have been in the world, the first to die in the struggle against fascism were the communists. I laid many wreaths upon the graves of communists. That is not criminal. Chief Justice Warren has been very clear that the Fifth Amendment does not have anything to do with the inference of criminality, and I invoke the Fifth Amendment.
Have you ever been known under the name of John Thomas?
Oh, please, does somebody here want me to put up a perjury someplace? John Thomas, my name is Paul Robeson, and anything I have to say, I have said in public all over the world, and that is why I'm here today.
Mr. Chairman, I ask that you direct the witness to answer the question he's making his speech.
I ask you to affirm or deny the fact that your Communist Party name was John Thomas.
I invoke the Fifth Amendment. This is really ridiculous.
The witness talks very loud when he makes a speech, but when he invokes the Fifth Amendment, I can't hear him.
I have medals for diction. Right. I can talk plenty loud.
Will you talk a little louder?
I invoke the Fifth Amendment loudly.
Sir, who are Mr. and Mrs. Vladimir
Nikiev? I invoke the Fifth Amendment.
Do you know a Manning Johnson?
I invoke the Fifth Amendment.
Do you know Gregory Kifetz?
I invoke the Fifth Amendment.
Do you know a Max Juergen?
I invoke the Fifth Amendment.
Max Juergen.
Why don't you have these people here to be cross-examined? Could I ask whether this is legal?
This is not only legal, but usual. By unanimous vote, this committee has been instructed to perform this very distasteful task.
To whom am I talking?
You're speaking to the chairman of the committee.
Mr. Walter?
Yes.
The Pennsylvania Walter?
That is right.
Representative of the steel workers?
That is right.
And the coal mining workers?
That is right.
Not United States Steel, by any chance. A great patriot.
That is right.
You are the author of the bills that are going to keep all kinds of decent people out of the country.
No, only your kind.
Colored people like myself. And you would let in the Teutonic Anglo-Saxon stock.
We are trying to make it easier to get rid of your kind, too.
You don't want any colored people to come in. Could I be allowed to read from my statement?
Will you just tell this committee, please, while under oath, Mr. Robeson, the communist who participated in the preparation of that statement?
Oh, please. The reason I'm here today, from the mouth of the State Department itself, is I should not be allowed to travel because I have struggled for the independence of the colonial peoples of Africa. The other reason I'm here today, again, from the State Department and from the record of the Court of Appeals, is that when I am abroad, I speak out against injustices against the Negro people in this land. That is why I'm here. I'm not being tried for whether I'm a communist. I'm being tried for fighting for the rights of my people, who are still second-class citizens in this country, in this United States of America. My mother was born in your state, and my mother was a Quaker. My ancestors, in the time of Washington, baked bread for George Washington's troops when they crossed the Delaware. My father was a slave. I stand here struggling for the rights of my people to be full citizens in this country, and they are not. They are not in Mississippi. They are not in Montgomery, Alabama. They are not in Washington. They are nowhere. And that is why I am here today. You want to shut up every Negro who has the courage to stand up and fight for the rights of his people, for the rights of workers. And I have been on many a picket line for the steel workers, too. And that is why I'm here today.
Would you tell us whether or not you know Thomas W. Young?
I invoke the Fifth Amendment.
Thomas W. Young is a Negro president of the Guide Publishing Company. I'd like to read you his testimony, quote, Paul Robeson has no moral right to place in jeopardy the welfare of the American Negro to advance a foreign cause. In the eyes of the Negro people, this false prophet is unfaithful to their country and they repudiate him, close quote. Do you know the man that said that?
I invoke the Fifth Amendment now. Can I read my statement? It is a sad and bitter comment.
While you were in Paris in 1949, Mr. Robeson, did you tell an audience the American Negro would never go to war against the Soviet government?
May I say that is slightly out of context. May I explain to you what I did say? I remember the speech very well. 2,000 students who came from populations that would range to 600 or 700 million people asked me to say in their name that they did not want war. No part of my speech in Paris says 15 million American Negroes would do anything. I said it was my feeling that the American people would struggle for peace, and that has been since underscored by the President of these United States. Now, in passing, I said...
Do you know any people who want war?
Listen to me. I said it was unthinkable to me that any people could take up arms in the name of a man like Senator Eastland of Mississippi against anybody. Gentlemen, I still say that.
This United States government should go to Mississippi and protect my people. That is what it should do.
I lay before you, sir, an article, quote, "I am looking for full freedom," unquote, by Paul Robeson in The Worker, July 3rd, 1949, quote, "I said it was unthinkable that the Negro people of America or elsewhere could be drawn into war with the Soviet Union. I repeat it with a hundredfold emphasis, they will not," close quote.
And, gentlemen, they have not. It is clear that no Americans are going to go to war with the Soviet Union.
While you were in Stockholm, did you make a little speech?
I made all kinds of speeches.
Let me read you a quotation.
Let me listen.
Do so, please.
I am a lawyer.
It would be a revelation if you would listen to counsel.
In good company, I usually listen. But you know, people wander around in such fancy places.
You said, Mr. Robeson, and I quote, "I belong to the American resistance movement, which fights against American imperialism, just as the resistance movement fought against Hitler."
Just like Frederick Douglass and Harriet Tubman were underground railroaders and fighting for our freedom, you bet your life.
I have to insist that you listen to these questions.
I am listening.
I quote further, "Why should the Negroes ever fight against the only nation in the world where racial discrimination is prohibited and where the people can live freely? Never. They will never fight against either the Soviet Union or the people's democracies," close quote. Did you make that statement?
I do not remember, but what is perfectly clear today is that 900 million people, other colored people, have told you they will not. 400 million in India and millions everywhere have told you
the
that.
The witness has answered the question. He doesn't need to make a speech.
Did you write an article that was published in the USSR Information Bulletin?
Yes.
Quote, "I want to emphasize that only here in the Soviet Union did I feel that I was a real man with a capital M," close quote.
I would say, what is your name?
Errant.
I am quite willing to answer the question. When I was a singer years ago, and this you will have to listen to.
I am listening.
I am a bass singer, and so for me, it was Chelyapin, the great Russian bass, not Caruso the tenor. I learned the Russian language to sing their songs. I wish you would listen now.
Mr. Chairman, I ask you to direct the witness to answer the question.
Just be fair with me.
I ask for order.
The great poet of Russia is of African blood.
Well, let's not go so far afield.
It is important to explain this.
Did you make that statement?
When I first went to Russia in 1934...
Did you make that statement?
When I first went to Russia in 1934...
Did you make that statement?
In Russia, I felt for the first time like a full human being. No color prejudice like in Mississippi. No color prejudice like in Washington. It was the first time I felt like a human being. Well, I do not feel the pressure of color as I feel it in this committee today.
Why do you not stay in Russia?
Because my father was a slave, and my people died to build this country. And I'm going to stay here and have a part of it just like you, and no fascist-minded people will drive me from it. Is that clear?
You are here because you are promoting the communist cause.
I am here because I am opposing the neo-fascist cause, which I see arising in these committees. Jefferson could be sitting here, and Frederick Douglass could be sitting here. Eugene Debs could be sitting here.
Now, what prejudice are you talking about? You were graduated from Rutgers. You were graduated from the University of Pennsylvania. I remember seeing you play football at Lehigh. There's no prejudice against you.
Just a moment. This is something I challenge very deeply, that the success of a few Negroes can make up for $700 a year for thousands of Negro families in the South. My father was a slave, and I have cousins who are sharecroppers. I do not see success in terms of myself. I have sacrificed hundreds of thousands of dollars for what I believe in.
While you were in Moscow, Mr. Robeson, did you make a speech lauding Stalin?
I can't remember.
Have you recently changed
your
mind about Stalin?
What Stalin, gentlemen, is a question for the Soviet Union, and I won't argue with a representative of the people who, in building America, wasted the lives of my people. You are responsible, you and your forebears, for 60 to 100 million black people dying in the slave ships and on the plantations. Don't you ask me about anybody.
I'm sure you wouldn't want to discuss with us the slave labor camps in the Soviet Union.
Nothing could be built more on slavery than this society, I assure you.
I would invite your attention to the Daily Worker of June 29, 1949, with reference to a get-together with you and Ben Davis, formerly communist councilman in New York. Do you know Ben Davis?
One of my dearest friends. He is as patriotic an American as can be. And you, gentlemen, are the non-patriots.
Just a minute.
are the un-American.
The hearing is now adjourned.
I think it should be.
I've been doing all of this that I can.
Can I read my statement?
No! The meeting is adjourned.
It should be.
So yeah, I felt like that would be a really good way to just get a feel for the strength of character, like I said, and the boldness of Robeson, the lawyer, right? Who was able to just stay on top of such ignorant discrimination and intimidation. What had happened afterwards is very interesting because internationally, there was a huge campaign. All of the friends that he had built up over the decades were increasingly, especially a lot of the people that he met and befriended in the 20s in London, were increasingly becoming leaders of their countries in Africa, and Jawaharlal Nehru was one of them in India. Scottish miners in Wales, who he marched with in the 20s and 30s. I mentioned the movie Proud Valley that he said was his greatest movie. It's really worth watching. Which is a celebration of the Welsh miners and their singing culture, their bel canto singing culture, which is, it's a musical movie, but a movie about the resistance of the miners against these corporate sociopaths trying to just destroy, to just treat them like silkworms, you know, pulling all the silk out and then just throwing away the corpse when the mine is dry, and how they fought and marched to Parliament. So, I mean, he had built up networks of allies around the world who put an immense amount of pressure on the United States to release him. And there was something called the Let Paul Robeson Sing campaign that endured for several years. It was led by the Welsh and Scottish miners. And the Exonerate Paul Robeson movement as well, I think is a very interesting one, which in India took the lead. A lot of the Indian artists and politicians loved Robeson, and they took the lead protesting and organizing official protests against the American embassies in India, and in Bengal was a big hub of this. At the World Peace Council Bulletin, January 1955, I extracted a little excerpt from one of their international calls to defend both Robeson and Charlie Chaplin, where the quote reads, "Appreciating the services of Paul Robeson and Charlie Chaplin in the cause of peace and creative endeavor, about 100 film and radio artists, technicians, directors, and producers of West Bengal issued an appeal to all lovers of art in the country to protest against the restrictions imposed on them by the rulers of the United States of America. They have gagged the voice of Paul Robeson, not only in America, but have at length barred the outside world to him. They have similarly barred the door of America to Charlie Chaplin. It is the bounden duty of all of the art lovers of the world, and particularly the artists, to raise their voice against this gross act of ingratitude. The art creations of Paul Robeson and Charlie Chaplin belong to the whole world. We cannot allow anybody to stifle them." Just to say, there were politicians, representatives from so many governments that signed these petitions, and they were putting their full weight behind the pressure to exonerate Paul Robeson, that it finally worked. And in 1958, there was a new, what I like to call the Phoenix moment. So the State Department broke under the pressure and finally granted Paul Robeson his passport back. And at that time, the blacklist was over for him, at least. And Carnegie Hall was rented to him for the first time, where he had a big comeback concert. And I've played a few of the selections from that concert already earlier on in this lecture. This is Paul Robeson at the World Youth Conference Congress in Vienna, where you could just see these students from around the world, from Africa, from China, who are just so happy. They're so proud of being next to Paul Robeson, giving these flowers and these awards. It's really nice. And at this time as well, he writes his autobiography with the help of his son, Here I Stand, which is made into a really good documentary. He meets Nasser of Egypt. He meets Lumumba of Congo. He's in communications with Kwame Nkrumah, like I said, who's all of these figures are really leading independent struggles. This is him just a year earlier when Jawaharlal Nehru went to New York at the United Nations. They had a highly publicized meeting. And also a little bit before that, in 1955, at the Bandung Conference, the famous conference with all of the different Asian and African countries and countries of the non-aligned movement who had gotten together to set up the terms of what are called the five principles of peaceful coexistence, premised around the same principles of the UN Charter, the respect of each other's sovereignty, the mutual respect of each other's traditions and cultures, in spite of whether you're a Marxist or a capitalist or whatever form. The principles of the Bandung are wonderful and very much in alignment with the principles of Westphalia, of the benefit of the other. So Robeson was invited to speak at that conference, and it was a great pain in his life that he couldn't go there personally, but he did send a message that was read there in support of the principles of peaceful coexistence. Here's a picture of him in 1959 in London's Trafalgar Square, where he's protesting against the use of the H-bomb. This is June 28th, 1959. And again, he's reemerging as a leader of the anti-colonial struggle, and he's, and a lot more. So at this point, I would just like to play one last segment, a 3-minute segment this time. Oh, by the way, this is where he's also in Stratford on the Avon performing Othello for the third time. And unfortunately, there's no, as far as I see it, surviving video footage that exists of these performances, even though in the case of New York, he performed it record-breaking 250 times. It's still a record for any Shakespeare performance on Broadway. Stratford, you just can't find anything. There's segments which are worth listening to, and it's wonderful to listen to his oration of Othello, but it's, you know. So anyway, you could just see him now picking up where he left off directly. And in this this final segment, this final selection is again a political selection. This is in Australia. So he's been doing world tours. He's been to India. He's in Australia. He's doing a 3-minute skit, a segment from an interview where you could get across his vision and what he's about to pick up on now that he's out of exile and he's about to return to America. He's planning his return.
That the American Negro, who for so long has been a second-class citizen in the United States,
still is. I'm sorry.
How is it that he's contributed so much to American culture?
Well,
music, dance, everything you can think
of. Well, I have to be very modest about that. I would say certainly, as we look at the African peoples in Nigeria, for example, I just got a wonderful invitation to go to Nigeria to be present at the installation Governor General Ezekwe, an old friend, who will now, and I had to cable him, I'm in Australia. I certainly would like to be with you, but I'm out here with some good folks, but I'll get to Nigeria later.
Mr. Robeson, do you feel that Africa is to some extent an affinity for it, a home, or do you still feel America is essentially your home? How do you feel?
I'll come to that in just a second, but to come back to it, so I would say the Africans and the American Negroes have turned out to be an extraordinarily gifted people. The great tragedy is that by not making us full-class citizens as yet in America, they may be losing, I don't know how much yet. That's all. And to come back, I would say that unquestionably, I am an American, born there, my father slaved there. Upon the backs of my people was developed the primary wealth of America, the primary wealth. You have to have accumulated wealth to start, you know, to build. You did it another way here in Australia. You had to build your accumulated wealth too. You just came and took it, you know what I mean? And that's what they did in most of the countries. That's what you Europeans did. You just took it. We got to catch up with you a little bit. And so in America. So there's a lot of America that belongs to me yet, you understand? But just like a Scottish American is proud of being from Scotland, I'm proud for being African. Now, in our school books, they tried to tell me that all Africans were savages, till I got to London and found most of the Africans I knew were going to Oxford and Cambridge and doing very well, and learned their culture. And even once, somebody had the temerity, after one had conquered the Chinese people and imposed upon them the opium trade and everything else, to suggest that they were a backward people, just the people who had been civilized so long over the rest of you folks didn't make any sense at all. So somewhere, it was wonderful to find about the colored peoples of the world that they were very advanced. So I would say today that I'm an American who is infinitely prouder to be of African descent, no question about it, no question about it. I'm an Afro-American, and I don't use the word American ever loosely again.
Now, this was the feeling. Right. This was the feeling.
That's right.
That when you're in London about 1937, 1938, you really had the world at your feet. Then, I mean, you're a tremendous success. You were recognised over the world, and yet you went back to America. Was this, right. this was the feeling that took you back?
I felt I had to go back to my people. That's right. The going was tough, and today I can go back. I just had my passport renewed. I could go back to pretty tough times now. But any time I could get a telegram next week that the Negro people had gathered somewhere in one of their conferences, as they could, and say, Paul, in the difficulties that are going on in America, would you come back and help us? I would take the plane as soon as I finished my engagements.
So indeed, it was the case that Robeson did receive the call to conscience, as Martin Luther King called it later. And at a certain point in 1961, he had made the decision to return back to America and to essentially lead the civil rights movement. But from the standpoint of everything we've just seen, right, he's not just coming at it from the standpoint of civil rights, but unified to every other aspect of oligarchism and the fight against it, with a cultural creative drive. And I think that that's super important. His plan in March was to leave London on March 1961 and to do a world tour where you would do concerts and have meetings with world leaders, starting with Moscow, and then after Moscow to go to India, and then after India to go to Cuba, to Africa, and then China, and then Cuba, where he was scheduled to meet with Fidel Castro and Che Guevara, and then land in America and begin to really take up the torch. Now, unfortunately, Robeson didn't make it past Moscow. What we know happened at that point, let me just take one of these things, stop sharing. So we know at that point, something strange happened in Moscow. He was invited into a party at a hotel. It was later discovered that the organizers of this party were Soviet dissidents on the pay of the CIA. During this party, something happened. He locks himself in a room, as the story goes. He's in a hallucinogenic fit of paranoia and tries to cut his wrists. He ends up in a psychiatric clinic and is quickly brought into London's Priory Hospital, where he's forced to remain for nearly 2 years. At the beginning of that stay, right upon his entry into the Priory Hospital, he's given 54 electroshock therapy treatments. I shouldn't call them therapy, torture treatments is more like it. He's also given large doses of psychoactive drugs along with those electroshocks. And his son, Paul Robeson Jr., in doing research over the years to figure out what happened to his father, realized that three of the clinicians at Priory were all CIA contractors, and each one of the electroshock therapies was being overseen by MI5 operative each time. It's probably BZ. So his son presumed that it was BZ that was the drug used that was created specifically by the CIA and MI6 in order to create paranoia, schizophrenia, and suicidal impulses. Whatever the case was, Robeson was not able to make it to America and become the leader of the civil rights movement. He luckily had friends who were able to pull him out of Priory in London and brought him to East Berlin, where he was treated more healthily. He was taken off of electroshock. He was taken off of the drugs. He was given a more humane treatment, but the old Paul never quite recovered. And finally, in August 1963, he was brought back to America. He gave several speeches, small speeches now and again, usually recorded throughout that time, to give support to the civil rights movement and other things. Kwame Nkrumah of Ghana offered him, saw his plight and said, Paul, come to Ghana. I'll make you the chair of the history department at our university. He wasn't able to say yes to that. But this is why history really is in a form, in a way, it is a tragedy. And you can only understand history as tragedy. And that's why I chose to call this an unfinished symphony, because Paul Robeson's life was a symphony, and it itself represented something which didn't quite see its full completion, even though the last years of his life, the last, 14 years of seclusion, he was celebrated in India. Festivals were made in his honor. Martin Luther King commented that the love of African-American spirituals in India is so high that when I'm there speaking, when he was meeting with different leaders in India, he said that my wife has to give more concerts than I do speaking. That's all they want to hear is African-American spirituals. Coretta Scott King, keep in mind, this is one of the connections to Martin Luther King directly. She was inspired to become a political activist and Renaissance woman when she was a student in the 40s and had met Paul Robeson. She was a singer, a concert singer. I think she was in Juilliard. And he encouraged her. She was inspired by his example and wanted to devote her life to civil rights and to music, which is why in the 60s, she was able to, as the wife of Martin Luther King, she was able to organize freedom concerts that were a big part of the civil rights movement that utilized the spirituals that Paul Robeson popularized. And this was largely what gave the civil rights movement its fiber, its ability, its spiritual strength to overcome all of the violent resistance that the civil rights leaders and the people who were part of that movement had to suffer. the thing that I think is very worthwhile ending on here is a little statement that Paul Robeson made towards one of his last public statements. Sorry. In January 1961, before he leaves Britain, he gave a speech where he said, despite common suffering, an even greater responsibility lies upon us to guarantee our children and all children everywhere that we shall do everything in our collective power to refrain our would-be world dominators, our would-be new masters of the century. They must understand that while we are uttering these very words, a new day has dawned in Africa, in Latin America, in Asia. And this light awaits just beyond the horizon. And just because one soldier did fall in battle, I think that the fights that he waged and the seeds that he planted are very much alive and ripe to be, to grow even further right now, especially sitting as we are right now ourselves upon an age where we have one dying system trying to hold on for dear life, and another system represented by the multipolar alliance of Russia, China, the Belt and Road Initiative, the Polar Silk Road, and the 135 countries that are increasingly participating in that new paradigm of win-win cooperation, long-term development, and really ending poverty, hunger, which is what Franklin Roosevelt's Four Freedoms were always all about. That's what the United Nations Charter was always about, was ending world poverty and creating a situation of security, of freedom from want, of fear, and of hope, which you get with big projects where you're induced to find skills within yourself you didn't even know you had when you become an engineer in Africa building a water project sponsored by funding from China and from your own national institutions that are beginning to form because of the Belt and Road Initiative. So with that in mind, I thought that Paul Robeson in his comeback concert in Carnegie Hall chose to end it with a piece from Beethoven's Ninth Symphony, the Ode to Joy segment, which is taken from Schiller's famous poem. That's how he chose to end his concert in Carnegie Hall in 1958. And I think that it expresses the hope that we currently feel right now about this new age of mankind that finally might be permitted to blossom. So I'm just it's a 2 minute, 44 second clip that I think you'll all enjoy. And then we can, for those who wish, talk a little bit.
Menschen werden Brüder.
That's right. Let's go from the beginning.
The setting of the melody from the choral section of Beethoven's Ninth Symphony to the words by Schiller, all men are brothers, alle Menschen werden Brüder. Praise to joy the God descended, daughter of Elysium, ray of mirth and rapture blended, goddess, to thy shrine we come. By thy magic is united what stern custom parted white. All mankind are brothers plighted where thy gentle wings abide. Freude, schöne Goethe Funken, Tochter aus Elysium. Wir betreten feuertrunken, himmlische dein Heiligtum. Deine Zauber binden wieder, was die Mode streng geteilt. Alle Menschen werden Brüder, wo dein sanfter Flügel weilt. The road of peace before us, build it wide and deep and long. Speed the slow and check the eager, help the weak and curb the strong. None shall push aside another, none shall let another fall. March beside me, oh my brothers, all for one and one for all.
Far and wide as the eye can wander, heath and bog are everywhere. Not a bird sings out to cheer us, oaks are standing gaunt and bare. We are the peat bog soldiers, we're marching with our spades to the bog. Up and down the guards are pacing, no one can go through. Flight would mean a sure death facing, guns and barbed wire greet our view. We are the peat bog soldiers, we're marching with our spades to the bog. But for us there is no complaining, winter will in time be past. One day we shall cry rejoicing, homeland dear, you're mine at last. Then will the peat bog soldiers march no more with their spades to the bog. Doch für uns gibt es kein Klagen, ey, wie kann's nicht Winter sein? Einmal werden froh wir sagen, Heimat, du bist. bist wieder mein. Dann ziehen die Moorsoldaten nicht mehr mit dem Spaten ins Moor. Dann ziehen die Moorsoldaten nicht mehr mit dem Spaten ins Moor.